Established in 2009, it's a biennial festival, and this one's a slightly larger than the last one. A few new venues that we've kind of added across London. So I think we've got 15 different performance spaces across the capital, all presenting work for adult audience, all presenting work that's been created specifically for adult audiences, and all celebrating the art form of puppetry in all its wonderful different ways.
I mean, I think in London we're very lucky because we're seeing new stuff all the time, not always puppetry, but you're seeing things that are allied to puppetry, you know, whether it's dance or mime or movement or theatre or opera or whatever, you know, one's seeing so much. And I think if you're doing a puppet festival, you have to be careful that all the shows are good enough, because I think London audiences demand the very best of stuff. And puppetry, unless we're going to get the very best shown all the time, we've got to be careful not to turn audiences off by having just filling a program with a lot of things that aren't absolutely 100%. Mm-hmm. Because there are 100% things out there, we've just got to find them. Mm.
The production is called Angus Weaver of Grass, and it's about a man called Angus McPhee. I went away to fight in the Second World War, and something happened. Nobody quite knows what the trigger was, which triggered schizophrenia in him. He ended up in a mental asylum, and he was there for 50 years in the mental asylum. During that time, he was pretty much completely mute. He could speak, he just chose not to most people. And even the people that he did speak to, he wouldn't have a conversation with, he would respond. And as a kind of form of self-medication, he made things from grass. This is an exact replica of one of the pieces that still exists. This was one of the pieces that Joyce managed to salvage.
This year, we've got a little bit more of a European focus, really, in terms of artists that we brought over. We don't get a huge amount of funding for the festival, so we're limited in the kind of capacity of who we can bring over. But we've got Duda Paiva coming from the Netherlands with Bastard, which is a fantastic piece, been touring around the kind of European festivals.
That's Clementine. Yes, but my close friends, they just call me
The inspiration to make the show, it's through the novel from Boris Vian. storyline of the book is very unclear, very uncertain, but that it delivers a beautiful surreal aspect for the whole content. Mm. And I was triggered by that to make, and I thought only with puppets this novel would work well. And well, but I made a free adaptation. You know, at the same time I was reading the book, it was the moment in the Netherlands, in Holland, that it was changing government, right-wing, hating culture. They took out 65% from all of the budget. Orchestras, considered the best in the world, 100% killed. A lot of people on the streets right now. Mm-hmm. So I made the main character of the book, of Boris Vian. He arrives in a village, a barbarian village. And that's the same principle I took to make this show, but now it's an artist that is in a garbage dump. Mm. And he's trying to understand his position. And these puppets, these creatures, these poetic bodies that the puppets are, these theatrical bodies, they empower him, they humble the artist to go on. To you, to do some old concert.
On flannel, gentlemen. We've got Ella Retete, Dorian Gray, who are doing Rua Air, which is kind of balloon puppetry as never seen before. And these two guys that look like they're straight out of Clockwork Orange, with a strange tabletop set that kind of explores the possibilities of the balloon in different ways. And we've got the Philip Jonty Company, who are doing a much more sort of intimate object kind of manipulation piece.
Why have you made me? I don't understand. I used to be dead, but now I'm alive.
You, Sandra Goodhart.
That's me talking.
I love you, Albert Grimley. And then we kissed. That night, I said something to Sandra I've never said to anybody before.
It started off, I woke up and went, I've got a great idea for the title of a show, The Shop of Little Horrors. Isn't that brilliant? And Vicky, my business partner, went, I don't know, yeah, maybe. And I was going, no, it's brilliant, it's really funny. And then we applied for funding and got it, and then suddenly realised that it's a rubbish title for a show, because everybody goes, oh, is that the one with the plant? And no, it's not the one with the plant. It's different. It's The Shop of Little Horrors. So I like the idea of ventriloquism, mm-hmm. and making a show that was quite grotesque. That's where I wanted to go. I wanted to make a show, and I couldn't do ventriloquism, so I thought, well, if it was a man who made the ventriloquist dummies, he doesn't necessarily have to be good at it. He can make them, but he can't necessarily do it.
Thank you.
Well, hopefully the Suspense Festival just kind of opens people to the complexity of the kind of dramaturgy of the art form, and not just in terms of very pure kind of puppet theatre that uses the kind of long string marionettes of the puppet barge or the tabletop puppetry of Little Angel, but also people who are kind of mixing up using recycled materials with dancers, people that are kind of taking puppetry into unfamiliar spaces and where the environment is part of the work, people who are exploring, working with writers on kind of text-based approach that incorporates visual theatre. So hopefully it just kind of opens up things that can be satirical and populist through to avant-garde.
It's about a woman who is going through the ups and downs of bipolar disorder. So it's very engaging because it's also very fun. Because when you're in manic crisis, sometimes it's very fun. Life is extraordinary, so we also wanted to show that. So through the interaction between the puppets and the main character, you get to have this idea, and also how difficult it is to understand that you're manipulated by something.
Here at Suspense Festival, I staged a show called The Adventures of Curious Gans, which I performed together with Liz Walker and Abby Leventis and Adam Pleath doing music, live music, which was fantastic. Live trumpet and puppets, that's fun. I've always been fascinated by science and scientists through history, and I know almost nothing about it. So this show is sort of a culmination of the tiny bits of information of the scientific world that I have and put together in the idea of a character who is a kind of every scientist because he's curious about the world he lives in, which we all found out as a company that we certainly were. But without the knowledge ever quite going anywhere. So it was an interesting research, and we did a lot of fun research into the process of getting copper out of the ground and about Elizabethan copper smelting and travels to the New World. And yeah, it was a wonderful process of investigation, really.
I'm Roger, of Killing Roger. I'm the one, the old man that deals with emphysema, and it's got a very, very important part, you see, in this, of course, yeah. Naturally. And the show is, we look at assisted dying, emphysema, my old man here having emphysema and having a hard time of it, living at home by himself and this sort of thing, and it comes from a history with the company itself of people who know about caring and about what it means to look after somebody who's old and who's dying of stuff and so on. And there's quite a lot in it, actually.
Yeah.
It's very intense, I think, yes. Yeah. Don't you say, Shelley?
I think so. Well, it was written by Lawrence, who also wrote the music, inspired by kind of his mother's experience of the care industry, but also the story came from the question, could you kill somebody? And obviously no is the kind of normal answer that people would give, but then Lawrence then posed the second question, what if they asked you to? So it's kind of like this whole story is based around this idea of what would happen if somebody asked you to help them to die.
Little Angel Theatre has got a production as part of the festival, which we haven't had in previous festivals, and it sort of felt like that's been a kind of quite a major omission. So I've got a production of Macbeth.
I think I came up with the concept of birds because we, in our R&D, we started, I came in with three birds that I'd knocked up to be perhaps friends of the witches, but in fact they became the witches. And then we thought about it, and Pete said, okay, shall we do the witches as birds? And I said, yes, but don't let's stop there. Let's make everything birds. And I think that was a bit scary for him because he hadn't actually thought of that. But I couldn't see why they should be human puppets. You know, why human puppets? And once we thought it through, we thought, well, right, Macbeth's cock of the walk, and who would be better as the king, better than a swan, you know? And so you can kill a king off, and that doesn't upset anyone, but you kill a swan, and that's really a bit tragic. And I think it was really interesting. And then as we rehearsed, we found all these bird references in the text. It's almost as though Shakespeare had written it for birds, and that was really exciting.
What do you say now, Mr. Grimlake?
Boo! Boo, lad, boo! Boo! Boo!